Good morning, everyone. This is the post-launch news conference for SpaceX CRS-9. And here to talk about how the launch went and how the mission is going, we have Joel Montalbano, the International Space Station Deputy Program Manager for Utilization from NASA's Johnson Space Center, and Hans Konigsmann, the Vice President of Flight Reliability for SpaceX. And we'll begin first with Joel Montalbano. Joel?
Well, good morning again. It's exciting to have a Dragon back in orbit. It's a great day for SpaceX, a great day for NASA. The SpaceX team, just a phenomenal team. The launch campaign was just fantastic to watch, and we're proud of them, and again, excited to have the Dragon up in orbit. We're looking for a grapple of the vehicle. The Dragon's doing fine, looking for a grapple Wednesday morning, Eastern time, about 7 a.m. And as far as other activities, since we last talked, the Progress vehicle has launched, and Progress is doing fine. They'll be docking tomorrow evening around 8:23 Kennedy Space Center time. As far as the crew and the vehicle, they're doing great. We did pump the video live up to the crew, and so they were able to watch it. We'll talk to them in a couple hours and get their thoughts, but they're excited. The science that was brought up, the docking adapter that's brought up on the Dragon vehicle, we're, again, looking forward to putting that science, putting the vehicle and the docking adapter on board the International Space Station. As you're well aware, the docking adapter is another step forward to enabling the commercial crew vehicles, so we're excited that these guys are on board and Dragon is on its way to the International Space Station. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Joel. Now to Hans Korusman from SpaceX. Hans?
Yeah, good morning. Thanks for being here this time. Good day. It was really exciting. We had a really great launch on Falcon 9 and perfect orbit insertion on Dragon. The stage one came back to land, and if you miss the sonic boom, it's right there at it's actually called Landing Complex One. I botched that on the last press conference, and let's see. We struggled a little bit with the timeline early on, and the ground team, the launch team actually, and the pad team performed really, really awesome. I really want to shout out to them and got everything good together on the timeline and finished so that we could launch on time. These are launches that only have 1 second window, so you got to get ready when the time comes, and we were ready when the time came today. So really good day. I also talked to Elon after the launch, and he was excited that the stage was back and in good health, and everything was proceeding so well. And his comment was also that if we one day people will pay less attention to this, and that's actually the day when we succeed. So that's what I have for now.
All right, thank you, Hans. We're ready now to take questions. Please give your name and affiliation when the microphone comes to you. And we'll start here, right here with Ken.
Thanks, Ken Kramer for Universe Today and Northeast Astronomy Forum. Hans, I wonder if you could give us a preliminary assessment of the first stage. How did it fare on the landing? How did it go as expected?
From what I saw on the video and on the cameras, it looked about the same as the outcome stage, in very good shape. A little bit blackened by the reentry, but there was also I didn't see this on the opcom, but I saw the engines firing and the entry burn, and then they kept on glowing after that. So it was really good to see where the stage is. So from what I can see, in excellent shape, and probably pretty soon ready to fly again.
Thank you.
Further questions right here in the front.
Hi, Josh Schinner with the Orbital.Space. This question is for Hans. First of all, thanks for staying up with us.
Yes. Thank you.
So the ability to land the first stage of a rocket depends on where it's going, how fast it's going, yeah. And how far it's going. With Falcon Heavy slated for launch sometime later this year, will it have the same capabilities given that it is going to be going faster and farther?
So on Falcon Heavy, it depends. There's three stages, right? Two side boosters and a center core, and the two side boosters will be able to go back to land. On the center core, it probably depends a little bit on the mission, whether it goes back or whether it goes forward and lands on a drone ship. I believe we're going to, you know, make the drone ship landings as routine as the land landings. So I don't think it's going to make a big difference whether we land on the drone ship or on land. It just means that you have to ship it back, and it's going to spend a couple more days at sea.
Do you expect to attempt those landings on the first flight of the Falcon Heavy?
I think so, yes, yeah.
Thank you.
Question right here.
So Bill Jelen for We Report Space. So then with two side boosters coming back, one will go to landing zone one. Where will the other one go?
Landing zone two. Landing complex.
Where will that be?
Landing complex. So I believe we'll be working on a new pad just next to it. It's going to be not very far from it, but far enough so that the two stages are not influencing each other.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Let's switch over to the phones right now. We have James Dean on the line from Florida today. James?
Well, thank you, George. Hans, hard not to pay attention to these landings.
Can you speak
with
up a little bit?
Zones that you mentioned. I gather they were heard for, you know, great distances away from the Cape, and even maybe prompted some 911 calls tonight. I just wonder what your reaction is to that, and is it actually something that you might factor into mission planning in the future, just the timings of these things and, you know, how people will react to these?
Sorry, I missed the first part of your question, James.
Okay, I'm sorry. I was just interested in the sonic booms tonight. I understand we're heard a great distance away, and have prompted a few 911 calls, and I just wondered what your reaction is to that, and is it something that might factor into the planning of, you know, when you do landings in the future?
Yeah, so I think you're asking about the sonic boom, right? And did I understand that right? We actually have, we announced this, and we tell people that there's going to be a sonic boom. In my eyes, it's very similar to the shuttle. The shuttle had a really characteristic sonic boom that people could recognize. And even I remember that hearing that a couple of times in Los Angeles when it landed in, I think, Edwards. And it had a characteristic double boom, then people knew, oh, the shuttle is coming back. And so I think it's going to be the same thing eventually when people get used to this particular sonic boom being slightly different. They will say, you know, stage one comes back, Falcon comes back and lands on landing complex one. So I believe it's going to be the same thing. It takes some time to get used to it, and we will announce it in time and let people know.
Well, thanks so much, Hans. And I was just wondering if you could give us an update on what's coming up next on your manifest.
Next on the manifest is, I think, JC-16 and another geostationary satellite called Amos. Those are the next two.
Yeah, do you have an approximate, like a date for whatever's next?
So I didn't catch that.
Would you have a date for either one of them?
Oh, the dates? I think it's going to be, what's today? today is mid-July. So I believe it's in the first half of August is the JC set, and then the Amos, I think, is still by the end of August, if I remember this correctly.
Thank you.
Okay, we had another question on the phone. Mark Gotch.
Yes, hello. Mark Gotch, Historical Aerospace News. Hans, congratulations to yourself, Elon, and the dedicated people of SpaceX, NASA, and the 45th Space Wing. Again, this was a mission of perfection tonight, very reminiscent of the ORMCOM mission. You put it on the X once again. It was fantastic. Based on that success, I have a question for you, Hans, and that is this. What was the weight of the initial, what was the weight and initial speed of the first stage of the Falcon 9 returning to land as it did tonight?
You mean the weight by the time it separates?
Yes, when it was coming down and landed on the X.
I I don't remember exactly what the propellant weight is, but the stage itself weighs about around 60,000 pound-ish. But there's, of course, propellant in there. I'm sorry, we have to get back to you. I don't think I remember that number off the top of my head.
Okay. Thank you very much for answering my question.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, that's all on the phones. You can ask question on social media as well if you go to hashtag AskNASA. Meanwhile, we'll take another question here in the room.
Jeff Bauer, Space News. For Hans, I'm assuming with the next two launches of being geobirds that these will be ocean landing attempts. When would you next attempt a land landing again?
There's a CRS mission coming after that. I don't know the date of that, but there's, I believe, one or two more this year. And those landings are likely to go back. Those missions will likely include a land landing. Is that true?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, we got a question on social media.
That's correct. Trevor Robbins asks, do you think that LEO gravity will reveal new properties about the wax material and method of cooling?
Say that one more time.
Do you think that LEO gravity will reveal new properties about the wax material and method of cooling?
So, you know, we're, as you're well aware, we're doing science experiments all the time, and you know, that's kind of one of the benefits of the International Space Station, to do these experiments and see, does it, is it the testing, does it result what we expected? Or is it something that we didn't expect? And the cool thing about Space Station is with the crew up there, you can adjust the experiment. So if you see something, and, you know, for example, the question that the reader had, and it doesn't predict, it doesn't result in the how you predicted it, you can have the astronauts change things. So that's really the benefit of having a crew on board the space station.
And we'll go back to the phones. Bill Harwood from CBS has a question. Bill.
Yeah, thank you very much, George. This is for Joel. Can you give us a little update on the Cygnus plans for August 22nd? How realistic is that date? Have you guys finished your analysis of, you know, the engine issues that came up after their hot fire?
Okay.
Anything you can add on their schedule? Thanks.
Sure. So August 22nd is a good date right now. We've done the Orbital has done the work on the new trajectory. They've handed that over to the Wallops team. The Wallops team is taking a look at it and doing their assessment of the trajectory. But right now we're looking good for August 22nd.
Follow up. When you say they've you know redone their trajectory, do you mean that? That incorporates new throttle settings based on the vibration issue they had?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you very much.
Sure.
All right, let's come back. We'll take another couple here in the room. We'll rack it up right here.
Hi, Laurel Ann Whitlock with Spaceflight Insider. We actually have a question from one of our readers. Scotty Martin asks, will SpaceX's eventual rapid reusability allow for the construction of multiple space habitats that will drastically expand humanity's presence in space and allow for the development of in-orbit launch systems?
Yes. So, I mean... The whole goal is to lower the cost of space travel and space transportation, and so obviously that does enable things that were expensive and out of reach for a lot of, I guess, organizations and before. So ultimately, I think we will enable lower transportation costs and provide, you know, much cheaper access to space based on that.
All right, we got one more question on social media, and then that's going to conclude our briefing.
Sure, this comes from Kona, and this is a question for Hans. When will SpaceX start using Dragon vessels in CRS missions? Or reusing?
Oh, reuse, okay,
yeah,
that's important.
Dragon, yeah.
I think this depends largely also on NASA. We have a plan, I believe.
I think we're looking at SpaceX 11.
Yeah, I thought it's 11 or 12, something like that. And we are currently at 9, so not too far from now.
Okay, and we have one more here in the room.
Hi, Thaddeus Cesari with Video Shampoo. I was hoping to hear if to confirm if SpaceX was planning on reusing any other parts of the rockets they'll be sending.
Any other parts?
Payload fairings?
Yes, that is, I would say, in research work right now. We've been working on that. We will eventually, we hope eventually to be able to do that. There's going to be modifications on the fairing, and then we're going to test this out again. So it's going to be, I don't think I have a schedule on that, but it's going to be a couple more missions until we can work that out.
Is there an estimated cost reduction in doing so?
Well, the payload fairing is expensive, I want to say. It's a huge structure, and you know, we build it. It's made of composites within the factory, so it takes a lot of time to. It doesn't take too much time actually. I want to say, given the size of it, it's actually pretty quick. But it's nevertheless, it's still worth a lot of money. So I don't think I have a particular number that I can give you, but it's going to reduce cost.
All right, that's going to conclude the questions. We've got a launch replay for you to watch, and at that point, we will conclude our briefing. Thank you very much.
T-minus 3 seconds.
T-minus 10, 9.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Main engines up and running, and liftoff of the Falcon 9 to the space station, preparing for the arrival of commercial crews while continuing experiments for long-term living in space. Falcon 9 having cleared the tower.
Secure the pad. Pad net 8.